Your word is a lamp to my feet, Lord.
Your word is a light to my path.
Though the world around me tosses and tumbles,
I hold fast to you.
Though I have doubts and worries and wonder,
I hold fast to you.
Though my heart hurts, my spirit aches, and I lose my way,
I hold fast to you.
Though I encounter wickedness and hate seemingly around every corner,
I hold fast to you.
Your stories and your songs, O Lord,
remember me.
Your will and your way, O Lord,
they nudge me along.
Your presence and your promise, O Lord,
they give me hope.
Your world is my heritage and my heart,
and I will turn toward you forever.
I will hold fast to you,
and I will sing praises to your name.
Our sins are forgiven. Our scripture lesson today is from we didn't even have the prayer in here, so let's not do the prayer. So let us join together in prayer. For all the blessings of this life, we give thanks to you, Creator God, for families, friends, colleagues, neighbors, and strangers who nurture us, that the love of God may grow within, that your love, your word, like a seed, may grow to produce in us good fruit. May your love be like a seed, taking root and growing strong. For the leaders of various nations and cities, that they may hear your word and lead with strong hearts and gentle hands and generous spirits, with compassion and mercy, with wisdom and grace. May they reflect your will, guiding all their actions and decisions. May your seed be like a seed, may your love be like a seed, taking root and growing strong. For those who serve in harm's way, those who live in dangerous places, those who have to work in areas that are frightful, those who live in areas of war and strife, those who live in fear, those who worry about employment, bills, food, and struggle just to find dignity in life, for those whose relationships are strained because of all of the different issues happening right now, for politics, for disagreements, may your grace bring peace and safety to all people, one to another. For those who suffer from any illness or disease of mind, body, or spirit, restore these and all those we carry in our hearts to fullness of health. Health as only you, O God, can bring. May your mercy shower each of us with healing mercy and love. For those who struggle with COVID, especially Beall and his son, for Francene with nerve pain and a cyst on the spinal cord, for Kansas City and all that is happening there around the murder of that child. Lord, we lift them up to you. For Rod and for the stress that trying to sell a house brings, may you send the right person who is looking for that home. May your love be like a seed, taking root and growing strong. For those who are dying and for those who have died, send forth your comforting love. Give solace to those who mourn. Console those who grieve. May your grace surround us like a mantle upon our heads, a shawl upon our shoulders, a hand to hold our hand. May your love be like a seed taking root and growing strong. All these things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us all to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us not temptations, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right. Scripture. Our scripture lesson comes from Psalm 119, 105 through 112. It should sound very familiar to most of you. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it to observe your righteous ordinances. I am severely afflicted. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept my offerings of praise, O Lord, and teach me your ordinances. I hold my life in my hand continually, but I do not forget your law. The wicked have laid a snare for me, but I do not stray from your precepts. Your decrees are my heritage forever, They are the joy of my heart. I incline my heart to perform your statutes forever to the end. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So he climbed at the base of El Capitan in Yosemite National Park. He has biked from Hanoi to Ho Chi Minh City. He has climbed Mount Everest, and after accomplishing this feat, he was featured on the cover of Time magazine. Eric Weinmayer is blind, unsighted, can't see. He's been this way since he was a kid. When he was only 15 months old, he was diagnosed with juvenile juvenile eye disorder. Doctors said he would be totally blind by age 13, and he was. In 2001, he was interviewed in his home in Golden, Colorado, in the foothills of the Rocky Mountains. He told the story of a descent off of fate at the face of El Capitan. He was with several other climbers. They had already spent at least one night in a sling-enhanced bike back on the face, and were now trying to get off the mountain before nightfall. But they failed. Night descended on them before they were able to finish their descent. They were all in the dark. So they turned to the one man who had the most experience climbing in the dark, Eric. He led them down and out on the last pitch. The blind leading the sighted. Think of the psalmist as a less talented Eric Weinmayer. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path, he writes in verse 105. Today's psalm reading seems to be a series of moralistic quotations about the overriding importance of the word of God. Each verse sort of stands alone, but the psalmist says in verse 10 that the wicked have laid a snare for me, but I do not stray from your precepts. He is once again on the path, he mentions in verse 105. So this verse gives us a theme of how to walk in the dark. Sometimes it happens. We're in the dark. We're clueless in uncharted territory without lights, signal markers, hints, landmarks, white roadside stripes, a flashlight, a smartphone, or infrared night vision goggles. Eric Weinmayer is an amazing athlete and adventurer. He's kayaked, such times when we are without light in our lives can be terrifying. They often immobilize a person. Life comes to a standstill. Yet the psalmist doesn't feel this way. He, like us, is on a metaphorical path. The image of verse 105 is of a path obscured by darkness. It's an unknown path. If the way were a well-known path, the light might not be needed. Sometimes the light of the moon will be sufficient to guide someone who's traveling via a common, if narrow, pathway. We often walk our dogs in the dark by the light of the moon, but it's down a street that we know well. We know where most all the cracks are, and we can avoid them. This text suggests that the traveler is both in the dark and walking on an unknown path. This is why the wayfarer is so glad to have a lamp or a light. It illuminates where the feet are stepping, and it shows the path. These are two important considerations. You don't want to put your foot on a rock or a root upon which you might sprain your ankle or over which you might trip and fall. And second, we want to have some advance notice of the terrain ahead, perhaps to avoid stepping headlong into a ditch or worse, an abyss. And we want to have a sense of where we're going. When we're walking in the dark, we want to have some light on what is immediately before and below us. What does the Bible say about things that trip us and cause us to stumble? We want light on this path to make sure we can avoid a tree root, a jutting rock, or a rotting log. Imagine you're traveling in the family SUV at night on a narrow two-lane road. or returning from a long day in a big city where one of the kids has had something happening. We're tired and the road is unfamiliar and it's raining lightly. You're driving and you frequently opt to use your low beams rather than the high beams. I'm never as surprised about that. You think you want the high beams to see more, but I find myself too hitting low because I can see better what's immediately in front of me. Way out in the north, there are no lights going down a very, very narrow street that we travel all the time, and I still get nervous about what's out there. I'll never forget in Ames, we had a practice for a Christmas program, and in the midst of that, a huge snowstorm came, a blizzard. And I had to take that child home to, and I'd been there many times, but it was still a little unfamiliar. And in this blizzard, I am driving down the main road in Ames, and I came to a stop sign and felt completely confused. I couldn't see anything. I couldn't tell the stop. The signs for the street were covered in snow. It was all white. I truly had an anxiety attack at that moment, even though it was a street I traveled every single day. So sometimes we want to put on our low beams. You want to have a clear view of the immediate road in front of you. You don't like surprises. I know I don't. You want clarity. You want a nice wide view directly in front of you. And so that's true in life. We need that flashlight, that torch, the low beams to illuminate the real estate that's immediately before us. We want to know if dangers, hazards, or problems lie imminently before us, maybe a snake. To walk in God's path of right living means that we need to see or be aware of these hazards. What might they be? It might be a lust for money and material toys, electronic devices, if you're my children, excess food, excess alcohol, bad relationships that leave us exhausted, confused, or stressed. That can even include toxic friendships. Bad habits, desire for a person who is not our spouse, job-related stress, I can keep on. The psalmist says that the word of God casts light on these obstacles to wholesome living. Like navigating any highway, some things you've just got to go around and avoid. Other problems are like potholes. They need to be filled with solid material and passed right over. And some issues, like a tree across the road, need to be sawed up and emphatically removed. The Bible has plenty to say about the love of money, about smartphones, not so much. But in this case, the issue is one problem of disproportionate time as well as manners and courtesy. The Bible says plenty about our use of time and about manners, ditto for extramarital affairs and bad relationships. Scripture also provides plenty of guidance here. No need to pray about whether you should be in an affair. You shouldn't. No need for you to be another country music cliche, right? So next, when we're walking in the dark or we're driving down a dark road, we want to have some idea of what's ahead. So what does the Bible say about the path itself? Where are we going? We go back to the same road on which you're traveling after the kids have been at that busy time. And sometimes, especially after using low beams, you're satisfied that you're aware of the nature of the immediate road before you. I think for myself, going the main road going down to our road to turn off, I often put on the low beams when I'm a ways away. But when I'm real, after I've gone up that hill, I know that my street is coming, and so the high beams go on so I can see everything. I'm satisfied that everything is okay with the immediate road before me. So it's time then for me to see further away, because those low beams don't tell me anything of the dangers of someone traveling and where I might need to turn, right? So I turn on the high beams. This, now that road ahead of me is light. I can see the curves, I can see the turn, I can see oncoming traffic. And instantly, I can determine whether that long stretch of road before me is okay, if it's stretching or if it's twisting, those turns, and I know what I need to prepare for. So is the road predictable or is it wild and uncertain? High beams help us know that. God's word certainly is not a crystal ball. We can't go to it and glimpse our future. But it does cast light on best practices that are most likely to result in a life well lived, a life without extreme curves, dips, and valleys. Those high beams of God's word show us that a well-lived life is one that is given in service to others, in which words are used to encourage, in which self-denial is a good thing, in which we are outrageously kind and generous, in which we try to make life less difficult for others, in which we practice religious spiritual piety, and in which we are grateful for even the smallest blessings. I can keep listing things on and on here because a life lived in what the Bible calls a worthy manner is a life that has so many aspects, which is why such a life is grown, not built overnight. It grows or matures. This life is itself the journey, and God's word helps us along the path. These benefits of the light and lamp accrue to the traveler on one and only one condition. The light must be trained upon the path. If you shine your light in the bushes, hedges, and the trees, to the right or to the left to see if there might be dangers lurking over there, you are surely going to stumble on what's directly in front of yourself and hurt yourself. If you're walking in the dark, keep the light trained on the path. The value of Scripture is that it teaches and instructs us. All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work, says 2 Timothy. If we use Scripture for any other purpose, other than walking on that righteous path, we're going to have all sorts of difficulties. If we try to use the Bible to prove some sociological, political, or economic ideal, we're just inviting trouble. God's word is given to us to guide our feet along our daily and sometimes treacherous path. Eric Weyenmayer continues to challenge himself. He's the author of Touch the Top of the World, The Adversity Advantage, and most recently, No Barriers. This latter book is also the name of a movement. The No Barriers mission is to help people with challenges, and all of us to some extent, to turn into the storm of life, face barriers head on, embrace a pioneering and innovative spirit, and team up with great people to live rich in meaning and purpose. The motto to No Barriers, what's within you is stronger than what's in your way. This is good stuff. But let's remember that it's not only what is in us that is stronger than what's in our way, but who is in us that is stronger than what's in our way. Scripture reminds us that you, dear children, are from God and have overcome them because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. As followers of Jesus, we are no barriers. When we're walking in the dark, we have the light of the Word of God to guide us, as well as a sort of internal guidance system that helps us follow the path. Staying true to this Word and the inner voice of the Spirit of God will empower us to live, as the No Barriers Mission State puts it, a life that is rich in meaning and purpose. Amen. like I didn't include this offering piece, and I felt weird. So I could give this week, even though we will not be passing the offerings, with gladness, let us present the offerings of our life and labor to the Lord, for freely we have received, and freely we give. And we can, let's do the next verse. That's my theory.